if you don't have money, the pressure of going after evil things is much higher. You understand? So it's better for you to have it. But let me preach part three, occupy till I come. And how did we end up in occupy till I come? Luke 19, verse 13. Luke 19, verse 13. You know, we started from talking about blind Bartimaeus. Then we went over to talking about Zacchaeus. And of course, then the people were complaining about Zacchaeus. And then Jesus Christ gave them a parable of the miners, where he gave them money and what some translation says, he gave them gifts or talents, and he asked them to do one thing. He said to them, do business till I come. Amen? That's what he says. And many people never believe that God can tell them that one. This is what we are reading. This is the Bible, not mine. This New King James Version. It says, do business till I come. Occupy till I come. Expand territories till I come. Be better than how I'm leaving you till I come. Have increase till I come. That's what he meant by what he says. He says, you know, I want you to increase till I come. I want you to be productive till I come. He says, do business. Add value to yourself till I come. Every believer, it's a sin for you not to add value to yourself. That is disobedience to God. Because Jesus Christ, when he handed over the thing to them, he said to them, because he was talking about himself in this parable, you understand? He told them, be productive till I come. Add value to your life till I come. Become better. Don't let me find you the way I am leaving you now. That's what he said to them. And that's why he called the guy who did not add value to himself a wicked man. Because he didn't add value to himself. So for every one of us who are believers, God expects us to add value to ourselves. We can't remain the way we were last year. We can't remain the way we were 5 years ago. Every year you must ask yourself, what can I do to add value to myself? What can I do to be better than the way? That's why Jesus Christ said, do business till I come. You can say, I'm not a businessman. You're working for somebody there, but don't be an assistant for 10 years. See how you go from assistant to be a full position. From assistant to at least deputy. From deputy to at least whatever you are deputizing. Just move up the ladder. Add value to yourself. Amen. Ah, God. You know, today I want to talk about tithing. That's what I want to talk about, tithing. And, you know, there's a whole lot of things about tithing that people have said. And, of course, I'm going to share with us with a lot of the things that the Lord shared with me. Genesis chapter 14, verse 17. Why do I want to read this? Genesis 14, 17. There is what they call the place of first mention in the Bible. You know, when you don't understand certain things or where there's controversy or about certain things, then you go to the place where the thing was first mentioned so that you can have an understanding that when they mentioned it, what were the circumstances surrounding it? You understand this? So, you understand? So, we want to talk about the place of first mention. And please don't close your heart to this. Open your heart to it. You understand? Don't let it be foolishness to you or stumbling block. That is stumbling block about the way you think. And the king of Sodom went out. You know, the Bible is just, since there's no new Bible, you know, you might have read the thing several times, but then you read it one day and then so many things just comes up. That's the beauty of the Bible. And that's how you know that this is just not another book. This is a spiritually inspired thing. No one could have put all of this together. You know, like I heard something somebody said. He said, how you will know a man did not write this Bible is that if a man wrote it, he would not have put husband, love your wife. And how he knows that a woman did not write this is that the woman would not have put respect your husband. He said, so definitely, this book is not written by any human being. It is God inspired. Amen. And the king of Sodom went out to meet him at the valley of Shaveh, that is the king's valley. After his return from the defeat of Chedorlaomer and the kings who were with him. This is talking about Abraham. I don't want to read the whole story. This is talking about Abraham. Abraham. Then go on. Please follow this story. Then Melchizedek, the king of Salem, brought out bread and wine. And he was a priest of God Most High. And he blessed him and said, Blessed be Abraham of God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth. And blessed be God Most High, who has delivered your enemies into your hands. And he gave him a tithe of all. This was the first time tithe was mentioned in the Bible. Go on. Now the king of Sodom said to Abraham, I don't know whether you notice what happened here. Go back to where we started from, the first verse. Let me show you something. I never saw this before, but God showed this to me. The king of Sodom went to Abraham. Abraham was coming from a victory. He had, you know, they told him that Lot was captured. And so he gathered people, 318 of his servants who lived with him. So they went to battle, and God gave him a strategy of how they were going to win the battle. So he won the battle. On his way back from the battle, a victorious battle, the Bible says this one. The king of Sodom went out to meet him in the valley of Shaveh. That is the king's valley. Watch this now. Because you can read this over. I've read this thing over several times until I saw this a couple of days ago. Listen to this. The king of Sodom went to him. Look at the next verse. Verse 18. Then Melchizedek, king of Salem. Where did Melchizedek show up? They were talking about the king of Sodom. Now, all of a sudden, they talked about Melchizedek. Then you go to the next verse, verse 19 or 21. Now, the king of Sodom. Then he went back to the king of Sodom. They told us about king of Sodom. Now, all of a sudden, they talk about Melchizedek. Now, they went back, right, talking about the king of Sodom. I will tell you why I'm saying this one. And the king of Sodom said to Abraham, give me the persons and take the goods for yourself. Verse 22. But Abraham said to the king of Sodom, I have raised my hand to the Lord. Is somebody getting what happened now? God interjected him before he spoke to the king of Sodom. And after he had paid his tithe, and the king of Sodom has blessed him. The king of Salem, Melchizedek, has blessed him. Now the king of Sodom is offering him something. And look at his answer. Abraham said to the king of Sodom, I have raised my hand. I have been in a covenant. I've just done a covenant with God. I have raised my hand to the Lord. God Most High, the possessor of heaven and earth, the one who owns everything, that I will take nothing from a thread of a standard strap, that I will not take anything that is yours, lest you should say, I have made Abraham rich. Some of you are going to get this in 2 days' time. You got it? So, Sodom represents the world system. Sodom represents a sinful place, what we know about Sodom and Gomorrah. So the king of Sodom was going to meet him and give him an offer. It's this story reminds me of the story of Pharaoh. When in the book of Exodus, when, I don't have so much time. But, you know, there's a situation that happened with Moses and Pharaoh. When Moses went to meet Pharaoh and he told him that we are going, you know, let my people go and all of those things. And then Pharaoh says, no. Don't go. All right, you can go. But leave your young ones behind. And Pharaoh says, not even a hoof are we going to leave behind. The enemy gives us an alternative and a compromise. But thank God for what happened, that Melchizedek showed up and blessed him. And because he got the blessing of Melchizedek, he was able to say, I don't need the blessing of Sodom. Get that one later then. Abraham had been victorious. Then he met Melchizedek. Not that the king of Sodom showed up to offer a compromise, but God has shown up for him in form of Melchizedek. And Abraham paid tithe. We're talking about tithe. You'll get where I'm going now. Abraham paid tithe to Melchizedek. The question is, who is Melchizedek? Let's look at this in Hebrews 7, verse 1. Talking about tithing today. For this Melchizedek, the king of Salem, look at the profile of him, and you tell me who do you think this is. He says, king of Salem, that is Jerusalem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him. Go on. To whom Abraham gave a tenth part of all, first being translated the king of righteousness, that is Melchizedek, and then also king of Salem, meaning king of peace. Without father, without mother, this is talking about Melchizedek now, without genealogy, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like the Son of God, remains a priest continually. Who do you think he's talking about here? He's talking about Jesus Christ. So Melchizedek is a type, and when we say a shadow of what will happen. So Abraham, today we talk about Abraham's blessing. But what do we know about Melchizedek? And if you look at the New Testament, they kept talking about the order of Melchizedek. You know, when you say the order of something, it's the program or what you are going to do, the order of service. The two things, brothers and sisters, that gives us the order of Melchizedek, and I don't want this to be complicated, I want this to be very easy, are two things that happen with Melchizedek in the book of Genesis, where the tithe was first mentioned. It is, number one, bread and wine was given, and tithe was given. And they said that Jesus Christ is after the order of Melchizedek. And the only thing that happened with Melchizedek that we are aware of is that he gave Holy Communion, what we call Holy Communion, and tithe. And so today, we cannot say we have a relationship with Christ and we take the Holy Communion and we refuse to take the tithe when Jesus Christ is after the order of Melchizedek. Oh my God. I hope you get what I've just said now. So you cannot separate tithing and Holy Communion and say, I believe in Holy Communion, but I don't believe in tithing. When Jesus Christ is after the order of Melchizedek, and the only order of Melchizedek that we know is the Holy Communion, which is what happened in Genesis. He gave Abraham bread and what? Wine. Did we read that just now? He gave him bread and wine. And after he gave him bread and wine, what did Abraham do? He gave him the tithe. And he blessed him. And so when the king of Sodom, as an alternative, showed up, wanted to bless him, he said, no, I will not take anything from you. Why? Because I've already been blessed by God. The question for you this morning, the question for me this morning, is for us to ask, who is blessing us? Is this the king of Sodom or Melchizedek? Melchizedek is a type and a shadow of Jesus Christ. That's it. So where do you get your blessings from? And so we find out that Abraham getting the blessing from Melchizedek, listen to this, this is very interesting. If you continue to read the story in Hebrew, the man was already blessed. He was a blessed man out of a promise. That is Abraham. I'm going somewhere today, my God. Just like you and me, we have a promise in the Lord already, being a child of God. But though he had the promise, Melchizedek still blessed him. And so today we talk about Abraham's blessings are mine. What are Abraham's blessings? What he did was that he gave a tithe unto Melchizedek. Just like Jesus Christ gave all of us bread and wine at the communion table, he did that for this man. So it tells me one thing, that Abraham entered into a covenant relationship, because bread and wine that Jesus Christ gave at the communion table was a covenant relationship that he has with us. Those who are going to be born, those who are born again Christian, those who are going to be called Christian. He had that covenant with us by bread and wine. Melchizedek and Abraham had the covenant. And what was the covenant? The covenant was sealed by that bread and wine. And he, in turn, now did one thing, gave tithe to him. So for you and me, we must understand that tithing is a covenant relationship. It's not that I just want to do this, I don't feel like, no. Every time you don't do that, you are breaking covenant. I'm going to show you that today from the Bible. So Hebrews 7, verse 6 says, he blessed Abraham. Though Abraham was already blessed and had promises already. He was already blessed because he had 318 servants born into his household. Genesis 15:1. We looked at that God showed up for him in Genesis 1. Listen, let's look at Genesis 15:1. After this situation in Genesis 14, follow me please. God showed up after he rejected what the king of Sodom had given. I want to ask you today, are you receiving what king of Sodom is giving? Or are you receiving what Jesus Christ, who came in front of a man called Melchizedek, is giving? After he has done this, this is the next verse. After Genesis 14. After these things, what are these things? The things that has happened. Of Melchizedek blessing him, of him rejecting what Sodom has to, the king of Sodom has to give, which represents the king of the world, which represents the devil. Sodom and Gomorrah was a place of iniquity and sin. So after these things, when God saw what he did, Abraham did, don't forget, when the Bible was originally written, it was written like a prose, like a long essay or whatever we call it. It was a prose. It was in verses, like now. The verses was done by King James so that it can be easily readable. That's why we have it like this. So after this thing, the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision saying, do not be afraid, Abraham. I am your shield, your exceedingly great reward. That's why Solomon wrote that money is a defense. What do you use a shield for? It's for protection. So God is saying to him, with what you have done, I will always protect you. And how did he protect him? He gave him finances. Without those finances, he would never have been able to raise 318 people in his household. He would never have had that victory that he had. And so God is saying, I am your defense. And by being his defense, he provided for him. I'm talking about tithing today. You don't even have an idea where I'm going. I'm laying a background. So we found that in Genesis 28, verse 20. We found out that the next time anybody made a vow of a tithe, and Jacob made a vow. Please follow this story so that you don't want, I don't want to leave you confused. I want an understanding for this. Then Jacob made a vow saying, if God will be with me, and keep me in this way that I am going. He was going into a future that he was not sure of. He was running from his brother. He wasn't clear about what was going to happen. Like most of us, we don't know about tomorrow. But like this man, he knows who owns tomorrow. And don't forget, Abraham was his grandfather. And so he tells us that he has an understanding of tithing. Because people who do not know the Bible, people who have no understanding of the word of God, always says that tithing has to do with the law, and the law is over. I'm showing us now that tithing came before the law was given. Before the law. So since it didn't come with the law, it cannot go with the law. Listen to this. Then Jacob made a vow saying, if God will be with me and keep me in this very way that I'm going, I will give me bread to eat and clothing to put on, so that I come back to my father's house in peace. Then the Lord shall be my God. Continue, please. Look at what happened here. And this stone, which I have set as a pillar, shall be God's house. Listen to what he said. This is clear. He says, this stone I have set as a pillar shall be God's house. And of all that you give me, I will surely give a tenth to you. Continue. So Jacob went on to his journey and came to the land of the people of the east. Go back. Go back. Listen to what it says. So he tied, listen to what it says here. And this stone which I have set as a pillar shall be God's house. And of all that you give me, I will surely give a tenth to you. So what is he saying here? What he's saying here is that this stone represents God's house. And so this place where I have put up this pillar of God's house is the place I am coming back to give a tenth of it. There's a difference. It's not talking about a specific place. It's not talking about a place in general. It's talking about where he will bring the money. That where I will bring this tenth, will be a place where it is the house of God. That's what he said with that statement. So we found out that the stone was erected. That's God's house, and that's where he promised to bring his tithe. Leviticus 27 verse 30. Let's look at a couple of verses, then we quickly move on. We're getting out of time, but let's see. Leviticus. This is when now this thing became institutionalized. Tithing now became institutionalized and incorporated during the time of the law. But there's something I want to bring out here. Leviticus 27 verse 30. Leviticus. And all the tithe of the land, whether the seed of the land or of the fruit of the tree, is the Lord's. I want you to note this one because that's where the kicker really is here. It says that it is the Lord's. And then the next thing he said, which is very important, is that it is holy to the Lord. What does that mean, holy to the Lord? It means it's consecrated unto the Lord. The tithe is consecrated unto the Lord. It belongs to God. That's what it says. Listen to what it says. The fruit of the tree is the Lord's. That is, God owns this. And it is consecrated. When they say it's consecrated and holy, that means we are not supposed to touch it. You cannot be touching your tithe. That's what he explained here. So it is not, when we say that the tithe is not yours, that's why we say so. That it's not yours. It belongs to the Lord. So you are not supposed to touch it. Let's read Nehemiah 13 verse 12. You know, you can go and read Deuteronomy 14, 22 to 23. It just keeps saying that it's the Lord's, that the Lord's. 2 Chronicles 3, 16 is just telling us the same thing. But let's read Nehemiah 13, verse 12. Oh, sorry, Nehemiah, all right, 13, verse 12. Then all Judah brought the tithe of the grain and the new wine and the oil to the storehouse. That's important. They brought it, the tithe, to the storehouse. Because people always ask the question, where is the storehouse? We're going to talk about that. So the tithe was brought into a place called the storehouse. Nehemiah 10, 38. Nehemiah 10, 38. And the priests and the descendants of Aaron shall be with the Levites and all of them, shall bring up a tenth of the tithes to the house of God and to the rooms of the storehouse. So the storehouse is not a confusion. The storehouse is the house of God, which is the temple, which we call church now. That's where the storehouse is. So because people say, oh, no. You know, what is the storehouse? It's wherever you are fed. No. No. It's specific about where the storehouse is. And that's what it says. You're the tenth of the tithe, so the house of our God. And then in the house of our God, there are rooms that are there. In the house of our God, there are rooms that are there. And so that is what is the storehouse. Malachi chapter 3. Let's quickly move on. Because, right, we'll see where we get to. Malachi chapter 3, verse 6. Malachi 3, 6. Let's read this. You know, we all read Malachi 3. I know that they say a lot of people don't like Malachi. You understand? But you might not like it. You know, even if you tear it out of your own Bible, it doesn't matter. I have it in my Bible. But anyway, he says, look at what happened. Maybe I should give a background about Malachi. Malachi is the last prophet before the coming of the Messiah. Malachi is the last prophet before the coming of the Messiah. So, for the preparation of the coming of the Messiah and to get the hearts of the people in order, it was about tithing. To get the hearts of Malachi, it's not an accident that it was the last prophet talking about Messiah coming, Jesus coming. That was him. And so, to get the hearts of the people ready was about tithing. Amongst other things, though. But it was about tithing. So how can anybody say it's the Old Testament when God is saying for the Messiah to come and to get them ready, they must get their tithing in order. If tithing is not important to him, then he will not tell them to get their hearts in order for the coming of the Messiah. This is clear. I'm not talking about, I'm just explaining what we are reading. Listen to what he says. For I am the Lord, I do not change. Therefore, you are not consumed, O sons of Jacob. From the days of your father, you have gone away from my ordinances, and I have not kept them. Let's all read the next thing it says. Let's read it, please. But you said, this, he was preparing them for the coming Messiah. And he said to them, your hearts are no more with me. I want you to return to me. That's what he told them. I want you people to return to me. He says, because your hearts are gone away from me from the days of your father. Verse 8. Then he said to them, because they asked him, how shall we return to you? Because people don't know how this passage showed up. They just read it. They are saying, how do we then return to you? They are saying, we should return to you. This is the prophet Malachi saying that you guys, the Messiah is coming. You've got to put your house in order. And God was saying this. Then the next thing he says, that will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. But you say, in what way have we robbed you? So he told them, you have robbed me in tithes and offering. For the coming Messiah, he says, your heart is not with me. You need to return to me. So for the preparation of the Messiah, it says there's a problem with your giving. And this is what I shared last week. How do you know whether mammon is sitting on your heart or not? It's the way you handle money. So God is saying, and I said this last week, God says that my challenge is not the devil. My challenge is money. He says you cannot serve two masters. He didn't say God and the devil. He says God and money. Now, it makes sense why he's saying to you that the way you are handling your money, I'm not sure you're ready for the Messiah. I'm not sure. So he says, put your house in order concerning your money if you're expecting the Messiah. Don't forget when John the Baptist came. I shared this one with us last week. Those of us who are here, they asked him three things. Three different categories of people went to John the Baptist. What should we do to get our hearts right? The three of them, he talked about the way they handle their money. That's John the Baptist. You have two coats, give one out. Let's see your heart, whether you can part with what you paid for. That's what he said to them. He told the custom people, don't take more than, don't be greedy. Be satisfied with what you have. Because they were asking, how can we have fruits of repentance? The three things he told, the three categories, has to do with their money. You think about it. You spend more time every week seeking money than you seek God. You think about this. You spend more time every week seeking money than you see God. Seek God. Now, why are you surprised that it says the only contention I have for the heart of people is money? You think about it. You think more. You spend. Look at how many hours you spend going to work and coming back. When you go to work, what are you want? What do you want? Money. That's what you seek. But do you seek God like that, with the same passion that you seek money? No wonder he said that the only person contending in the hearts of the people is money. All right, let's go on. I've got so much to say. I don't know what I'm doing. Continue. Verse 9. Then he said, you are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this old nation. This should scare us. In the Garden of Eden, God says, don't touch this. He said, this one, don't touch it. Just the way he says that money is only unto God. That means don't touch it. It's sacred. It's consecrated unto God. So God consecrated that tree and said, don't touch this tree. When they touched the tree and hurt it, what happened to them was that they got a curse. That's what happened, which is what we're still suffering today. And when you look at why they got that thing, you know, say it's good for the eyes, it looks nice for whatever, the reasons that they gave. And it's the same thing we say today about money. And what did they get from what was consecrated? They got a curse and they exited the Eden. When they got to Jericho, God said this. He says, don't touch anything in Jericho because Jericho is mine. Whatever you get there belongs to the Lord. Because number one, it was the first city that they were going to possess in the promised land. So God says, that's my own first fruit. That's my own tithe. Don't touch it. When they touch it, when Achan took the Babylonish garment, you saw what happened. They got a curse. So whatever is the Lord, when you take it and you touch it, a curse follows it. I know you don't want to hear that, but it's the truth. That's what we just read. It says you are cursed with a curse. So when we look at everything that belongs to the Lord, that God says don't touch it, when God says this is mine, when they say this is consecrated unto the Lord, when we touch it, it's an abomination. Listen to what it says. It says you are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this old nation. This is Malachi preparing the people for the coming Messiah. Go on. Then he says, bring all the tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. And try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out such a blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. And so, a dialogue started between us and God with this passage. He told them that they have robbed him in tithes and offering. Then it says a curse. I looked at the dictionary, what it cost me. It means an evil that has been invoked upon you. The expression of a wish that is of misfortune. Evil doomed to befall a person. When I read this, I said, thank God I'm a tither. When I read it, it didn't matter to me. Because I just said, thank God I'm a tither. Then he went on to talk about the storehouse. Like I said earlier on in Nehemiah, we know what the storehouse is. He says, I want there to be meat. Let there be no lack of meat in my house. But there's lack of meat. That's why we say that the poorest thing is a church mouse. What an insult unto God who owns everything. The storehouse is not the poor. Because people say they give their tithe to the poor. No. You can't give your tithe to the poor. Because the poor is not your storehouse. You can't give your tithe to an orphanage. No matter how good it looks. That is the wisdom of Greeks. That's wisdom of Greeks. To say, there are people who need it. When that woman broke the alabaster box. And Judah said, this could have been given to the poor. Jesus says, forget that one. The poor you have with you always. This one is for my burial. It's for my glory. use that as an excuse. If you want to give to the poor, good, I give to the poor. But guess what? I give offering to the poor. You don't give your tithe to the poor. You don't own the tithe. It belongs to God. You can't give what you don't own. You can't give what you don't have. It's not yours. And so, it is not the hospital I give to the children's cancer thing. But I cannot give my tithes to them. Even when I see those things on television, I am touched to my core. But I cannot give my tithes to them. Because they are not my source. They don't own it. If you want to support them, you support them with an offering. That's what you do. Not your tithe. You can't give your tithe to the shelter. You can't give your tithe to the cancer center. You can't do that. Your tithe is not yours. You have no right to give what is not yours. What is the Lord? You have no right to do that. What is storehouse? And why did he say he does not want, he wants me? Because it's the place of abundant supplies. That's what the storehouse is. That's what the church is. It's a place where we share knowledge with us, where we share facts of the word of God with us. But he went on, which I feel is the major thing here that we need. He says, prove me. That alone is a whole sermon, my God. Where God is saying, you know, they say something about God, by two immutable things, it means that God cannot lie. You understand? And so God is saying, I cannot lie. You try me and you see what I will do. For God to say, prove me, he doesn't lie. God is saying, test me, for it's impossible for me to go back on my word. That is enough consolation for everybody. And then he talked about open windows. I will open the windows. What is windows for? Windows are for seeing and light. That's what windows are for. That's what windows are for. So what he's saying to you and me invariably is that I will show you opportunities. I will let you see the miraculous. Because that's what windows are for. It's for you to see things and for light to come. Light means what? Knowledge. Darkness means ignorance. So he's saying, I'm going to shine light. I'm going to let you have knowledge. I'm going to give you strategies. I'm going to give you abilities. I'm going to give you insight. I'm going to give you foresight for the future of what will happen. I'm going to let you have vision. Dollar does not pour from heaven. It doesn't. Because we've misunderstood that it will pour out. He says a blessing. Just one thing that is going to give to you. The word pour means abundance. I will give you abundance of insight, abundance of knowledge. Because that is how you make wealth. Money does not pour down. Windows is for seeing, it's for light. So it gives you knowledge, understanding. Let you see what other people are not seeing. That's what tithe does for you. And then it talks about you have not enough room, which means that what I'm going to show to you cannot be contained, cannot be stopped. It cannot be contained or stopped. It's going to be a great harvest. That's what I'm going to give to you. So, you think about people who make money. While they are sleeping, they are making money. That's what wealth is. Wealth is not when you get up 9 to 5 for you to make, but while you are sleeping, you are making money. That's what he's saying tithe can do for you. If only you understand and you embrace and you believe it. He gives you insight. He gives you ideas. He gives you what to say. You go for an interview. You go for something. He tells you what to write. The proposal to put in. Insight. Window is for seeing. And it's for light to come. So the purpose of tithing is to support the priesthood and the work of the ministry. That's what tithing is for. So that's why I say bring him. So that the gospel can continue to be preached. Do I agree that some of us pastors, we have mismanaged people's money? Yes, we have. But guess what? When the children of Eli, Ophni and Phinehas, when they mismanaged God's money, God punished them. That's what he did. So you leave the punishment to God. That's the thing. When they mismanaged it, God did not overlook their sin. When the children of Samuel did the same thing, he did not overlook it. They were supposed to be the priests. They were supposed to be, the people said, we want a king. And God honored what they wanted. Not that they liked it. But because of their action, the priest, they suffered for it. So if somebody is a pastor, is a priest, and is mismanaging the money, he will not go scot-free. Listen to me. The cane of the pastor is not in your hand. You leave it to God. I'm telling you, leave it to God. If you think they will get scot-free, they will never get scot-free by mismanaging people's money. But you have a duty. Give to God what belongs to God. You have that duty. Don't say, because they are going to mismanage my money, I'm not going to give. You leave that to God. Because you know why? You are stopping your own blessing because of somebody else. You leave that to God. We have enough something in the Bible that tells us that when they misbehave like that, God judges them. So the storehouse is where the gospel is preached, which is the church, where the work of God is done, where evangelism happens. Because the money also is to maintain the staff, the office, the people who work in the place. That's why you find out that they told the Levites who work in the temple for them to take the tithes so that they can keep the work going. You know, people say, oh, I don't want to give to that church. But you know what? I say this all the time. But they give. It's just they decide to give to the king of Sodom. That's the difference. That's what they do. They give to the world system. Do they go to the ExxonMobil MD that has $100 and something million? Every time you pump that fuel, you are enriching the directors and the stock. You just have to decide who you want to give to. You give, I'm telling you, to the guy in Macy's, to the CEO of Macy's, who is handing what your generation has never had and will never have. It's not the cause. When you see what those people hand, you say, did they pay the people this kind of money? And they pay some people $6.50, and they pay some people this kind of money. Why don't you go fight them? Why are you fighting the pastor? Go fight them. Because you are the one contributing. They will never be able to pay those people those money if you and me don't contribute to their purse. They will never be. They will never be. Oh, my God. I've got to finish this. I'm out of time, but you know, still have a couple of. Oh my! All right, let's just quickly move on. So, he said then in verse 11. Please put it back. I've seen the time remaining, but I'm not respecting that. Look at this. Listen to what he says, because if I don't preach it now, I won't have the passion that I have now to preach it again. So, listen to this. He says, "But I will rebuke the devourer for your sake, so that he will not destroy the fruit of your ground." Nor shall the vine fail to bear fruit for you in the field. I just like this Malachi. And the reason why I like it is not because I'm a pastor. Because I, as a Christian, I like it. Because I know, like he said, prove me, God cannot lie. So when he makes a promise that I'm going to rebuke the devourer, I believe what he's saying. What is a devourer? It's the one that consumes destructively. This is the dictionary thing. And a devourer is who destroy recklessly, who swallows hungrily. Some people have experienced what I'm talking about. Unnecessary things taking your money. Things that you're wondering, taking your money, spending money on sickness without a reason, can't account for how you have spent your money. That's a devourer. But God says, all those leakages, I will block it. Where those things are leaking, I will make sure they are not leaking. And then he went on to say, I like this one. I say this one all the time. Look what I was saying. Nor shall the vine fail to bear fruit for you in the field. You know, I think it's the Living Translation. Let's see the Living Translation of that something. You know, he says, you will not cast your young before its time. Your grapes will not fall from vine before they are ripe. Another word for that is what? Abortion. He says you will not suffer abortion. You know, when something casts its fruit before its time, you understand it's called that the thing was aborted. He says in your business, you will not suffer abortion. In your vision, you will not suffer abortion. With ideas, you will not suffer abortion. You know, starting and not finishing, it will not happen to you. You understand? It says dying in his infancy will not happen. That's what it says. So you're cheating yourself by not paying tithes. You do the thing and leave God to do the rest. Everyone that see you will know, like it says in verse 12. Look at verse 12. Verse 12. Then all nations will call you blessed. That is, everyone that sees you will say this one is blessed. They can see the peace of God, the glory of God upon you. Everyone that sees you will know that you are blessed, because the peace of God will be upon you. And they find out that whatever you lay your hands on will prosper. Because of what? Because you're a titan. Titan is a covenant between God and man. And he said something. That word he used, prove me, is a word that is a covenant statement. That is, he say, if you do your part, I will do mine. If you do your part, I will do mine. It's a covenant statement, he said. That's why I said we can talk about prove me for a long time. Just that word that says prove me is challenging us. You see whether I will do it. See whether, test me if I'm a liar. If I will not do this thing. God always sets things aside from the beginning to himself. Let me close with this. Matthew 20. Let's read Luke 11:42. It's the same thing in Matthew 23. But let's look. Luke 11:42. Let's read the New Living Translation. Many people have said, Pastor Ghandi, but Titan is not in the New Testament. I said, I don't know what you're talking about. It means you don't know the Bible or you don't read it. Because it's there. Jesus didn't talk about it. I said, who told you? It's there. It's just because you never read it. Listen to what he says. This is Luke 11, not Ghandi 11:42. Luke. Listen to what he says. What sorrow awaits you, Pharisees? You are careful to tithe. Even tiniest income from your herbs of your gardens. You tithe everything to the tiniest thing of the herbs that you have in your garden. But you ignore. Listen to this. This is English. I have a BA in English language. Listen to what it says. It says, but you ignore justice and the love of God. He said, you should what? I said, people say, he didn't say that. He said, you should tithe. Yes, you should tithe. I'm not saying you shouldn't. But do not neglect the more important things. Because tithing is basic of showing your relationship with God. They say Jesus didn't talk about it. This is there. He said the same thing in Matthew 23:23. He said he never said we shouldn't. He said you should tithe. He said that. He said, but there are other issues of justice, mercy, that you are ignoring. Because tithing is a low level of your Christianity. It's basic. That's it. Oh, God, I've got to say this one. He said, give unto Caesar what is Caesar. Caesar represents government. They asked him, listen to what he said. They asked him, should we pay taxes? They tempted him. He said, where is the coin? They showed him the coin. The coin had on it Caesar. He said, give unto Caesar what is Caesar. But he said, give unto the Lord. What is the Lord? All right, let me try and just say this in a minute. The question I want to leave in your heart. The coin had Caesar. And so he said, because what is super inscripted on the coin is Caesar. So it means it belongs to Caesar. So give it to Caesar. The question is, who is super inscripted on you? Whose image are you? Whose image is on you? If God's image is on you, that means you belong to God. And so you should give to God what is his own. That's what he said. He says, since he has Caesar, it belongs to Caesar. Go and give it to Caesar. But, listen. God does not print dollars. The person who prints dollar is Caesar, which represents government. We go out on a daily basis and get from Caesar in a battle. And we come back on a Sunday to change what we took from Caesar and give it to the Lord. The amount we give to the Lord tells us how victorious we are. Because Abraham, who started the tithing, when he had victory, was when he was moved to give a tenth of it to the Lord. The tenth was a product of the victory that God gave to him, because he knew there was no way he would have won. So how do we know you are winning? Is where you go out and take from Caesar, and you come back on a Sunday and give your tenth to say, God, I got this from Caesar. Now it is yours. You get that one on Thursday morning. Whose image are you? Listen to me. The only thing that will count for eternity is what we have done for God's kingdom. How we have used the resources God provided for us for the kingdom benefits. Tithing shows that we are part of God's kingdom. Because taxation shows the country of your residence. That's why they ask him, should we pay taxes? He says, yeah, you can pay taxes. So the government is Caesar. That's what the government is. But this is the thing. Caesar cannot trust you. So they take their tax at the source. But God can trust you because he knows you have a covenant with him now. Based upon your covenant, he says, bring it voluntarily. Caesar can trust you. They said, no, we don't deal like that. We can't trust human beings. So they take it as us. But God says, we are in covenant. I can trust you. There is no problem. I know you will bring it. That's why he says you should bring it. Babylon is being built. God laid this upon my heart yesterday. He says Babylon is being built because people pay taxes. But the house of God lieth in waste because people don't pay tithe. Babylon represents the government. It's being built. Why? Because the people pay their taxes. Even the president doesn't pay taxes. Yes, he's the president. But he now is living in Babylon and ruling over Babylon. That's to inject my opposition. If we are tithe, we won't need a building fund. We will not need a building fund if we are tithe. We will not be having to shake people if people voluntarily do it. God has put tithe in place for the work of his kingdom. Offering is what you give above the tithe. It is a free will giving. Offering is not tithe. Some people say, you know, oh, I tithe 5%. No, that's not tithe. That's an offering. Tithe is clear, is the tenth. So don't say, I pay my tithe. No, you can't decide what your tithe is. It's fixed, it's 10% of your increase and of your income. And even the money given to you. People give me money, but I tithe it. It's standard. I tithe my giving. Tithe is always 10% of income or their increase. Giving should be voluntarily. You should be willing. You should be cheerful. Because giving is an accountability to God. We must recognize that all we have is from God. We are called to be faithful stewards of all our possessions. People ask all the time, what's the difference? Should I pay gross or should I pay net? If you are starting, you can still pay net. But what God expects is the gross. If you want gross blessing, pay gross blessing. If you want net blessing, pay net. At least start from somewhere. Start, please. Because that's an excuse for not wanting to give. I'm confused. I don't know what I should do. No. Let your confusion end today. Start from somewhere. Pay 10% of net. Start from somewhere. It's for you. It's for your own blessing. I've given you a key. I tell people I tithe myself out of poverty. That's why I brought myself out of poverty. By tithing. I brought myself. So anytime I say, I know I can never be poor again, don't be angry at me. It's a statement of fact. Why? Because I've told you how the thing is. I have a covenant with God, and he has said I should prove him. That's what he said. He said I should prove him. And I know that it's impossible for God to lie. So I prove him. Every time I release that tithe, I'm proving him. That's what I do. It's so interesting. I was looking at the thing for my children. I didn't even know that they were paying. They are giving tithe and offering. And so they send something to us. You know, at least I think my wife did that to make sure that they are paying their tithes. When I look at what the two of them has given, it's a lot more than many people in this church. And then you can't envy those children. If in years to come they get scholarship, you can't envy them if in years to come they have great job. Because now what they are doing is that they are loading their cloud. So when the rain comes, you can't envy them. Because now from their childhood, they have started knowing the principle of prosperity. That is, in God's kingdom, it is sowing and reaping. I am not out of message, I'm out of time. Let's bow down our heads. Let's bow down our heads and just speak to the Lord. I believe that some of us are going to have to make commitment today. I'm saying it's a new day for me. I didn't understand this thing before, but now I understand it. That this thing does not belong to me, it belongs to God. It's not mine, it's God's own. It's sacred. He consecrated it. So I cannot be giving my money to whoever I want. No, I must give it to the storehouse. And so you have to decide which your storehouse is. Look for the storehouse you are comfortable with. If you are not comfortable here, go somewhere but give. That's the thing. Don't say it's because of the way they are doing this. No, don't use me as an excuse. You understand? Because my own greater days are still ahead. You haven't seen nothing yet. So don't use, oh, because it's the pastor, I'm not giving. No, no. Go and find a place where you are comfortable. Give your tithe. It's not yours. And see what God will do. He said, prove me. So every time you release it, say, God, I'm proving you. You're the one who says that you proved. I'm giving you because I love you. I'm giving you because it's covenant. We're in covenant. And based upon my covenant, that's why I'm doing this. Father, Lord, today, once again, we thank you. Thank you for the opportunity for us to talk about you. I don't know if you're here today, you want to accept Jesus as your Lord and your Savior. We want to give you that opportunity. Can you raise up your hand? I want to pray with you. The rest of us, let's make commitment. Those of us who are already doing it, let's tell the Lord that, Lord, I will not change. Give me the grace to continue to release it to you. Give me that grace. Give me the grace to continue to be faithful. Faithful stewards are always rewarded. Faithful stewards are always rewarded. Let me be faithful unto you, Lord. Let me be faithful. It's what God has put together for his work to be done, for gospel to be preached, for the homeless to be fed, from different things to be done, for the work of the ministry. So it's not yours. So it's not an option. People say, oh, I don't have enough left. No, take his own out first. Government did not trust you, so they take it out. But God can trust you that you will do it voluntarily. Father, Lord, we thank you. The ones that are mine, let them forget. The ones that are yours, let them remember. Let this sermon not come against anybody on Judgment Day. Let them be able to say, I had, and I obeyed your word. This is our prayer in Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord. Put those hands together for Jesus.